Hi, my name is Olivia Guest, and today I want to talk to you about how computational modeling can force theory building in psychological science. And this is some work that I did with my co-author, Andrea E. Martin. So yeah, before we jump in, I just want to give an overview. Firstly, I want to get into a little bit of the background of why we did this work, the kind of rationale behind why we thought this was needed. Then I want to talk a little bit about this idea that we've named pizza problems, which is that there are cases where computational models can uncover issues with our ideas, and without them, such issues wouldn't have been able to be spotted and wouldn't have been able to be addressed. Then we're going to get to the main idea that we want to share with you, which is our PATH model of psychological science. And then we want to give some ideas about what the future might hold and what changes we might be able to do in the present in order to incorporate computational modeling into wider psychological science. So why did we do this? So in the beginning of my PhD, I went to a talk by David Shanks, who had looked at various social psychology experiments and discovered that the way they were written up, so the journal articles didn't have enough information in order to replicate the published results. And that really got me thinking about the position of computational modeling, how that relates to wider psychological science and what role that can play in these situations. And I noticed that computational models weren't really being discussed or involved in this so-called replication crisis, being discussed by the wider field. This kind of figure, which shows words that represent different things that are being discussed in the last half of the last century in psychological science, the word theory or model doesn't really pop out. And this is another example where I really question where modeling fits in, or where computational modeling kind of isn't really being seen as playing a role. So this is like an overarching figure of psychological science research, where we have in black ink, we have the kind of important stages that research needs to go through, like specifying and testing hypotheses, designing studies, collecting data, on and on. And then in red, we have things that could go wrong. So failing to control for bias or p-hacking and so on. But nowhere in this cycle of research does computational modeling really play in there. And it really got me thinking, like, are we maybe not really in the same field? Is it that there are some people that do modeling and then other people that do something else? So kind of like Stephen Jay Gould's idea of non-overlapping magisteria. So is just computational modeling or formal modeling or whatever a different kind of science? Or is it that there's just something lacking in the broader dialogue between us and people who don't do any modeling? So here I want to just give you an example of something that really hits home for me. So I tweeted why we need computational modeling. Even if somebody agrees what the area of a circle is defined as, there are apparently people unwilling to execute the formal model itself. And not only that, but the results are counterintuitive. So here what's going on is that there's two pizza order options, one with 18 inches in diameter and one order with two pizzas with 12 inches in diameter. And I think the average person, or at least I would assume that the two 12-inch pizzas have more overall food, when in reality, if we run the kind of model that we all sort of agree on that could capture the amount of food, the pizza with the single pizza with the 18-inch diameter has more food. So as this caption here says, an 18-inch pizza has more pizza than two 12-inch pizzas, and people are losing their mind. And below that it says, math is important, people. So math is very important, obviously, but it's not enough. So in this situation, when we can specify the models, the formal models that capture the amount of food, and we agree on that, even in this case, there are people who might still infer, without running the model, that the two pizzas are more food. And one way of addressing this and discovering what our intuitions actually lead to is by taking this specification and implementing it using code. So essentially writing down all of these things, but in a way that can be executed by a computer. So here we have like a function that calculates the amount of food per order as defined previously in the specification. And then we plug in the two pizza orders with 12-inch diameters and then the one pizza order with 18 inch diameter and compare the two. So ask the model, is the two pizza order more food than the one pizza order? And get a result there that we can then go on and empirically test if we really wanted to. This is obviously a toy example. But what else can happen here is that we can then move back up and refine our specification, generalize it in ways that we believe are appropriate generalizations. So this is just a generalization to calculate the sum of surface areas of circles. And this is a decision rule. So very, very simple model, but I think it underlines that there are cases in which just a formal model without a computational model is sometimes not enough or doesn't provide as much information, as much kind of debugging of our scientific thinking as just writing down some maths, which is still nonetheless extremely useful. Just to kind of zoom out before we jump back in to speaking about our PATH model that we've touched on a tiny bit by talking about implementation specification, I just want to give a sort of caricature, just in order to really underline that it's wrong, of what empirical people who don't do any modeling, so people who do mostly or completely empirical stuff, might think computational modeling is. So what they think that we might be doing is that we start off as modelers with some data, then move on to a hypothesis, then move on to an implementation, then a spec, then a theory, and then this kind of overarching, very general framework. And by the same token, a lot of people that do experiments, empirical work, might think that they kind of do this caricature, which again, I'm going to say is worth thinking about and maybe understanding that it's not true. So this is the kind of inverse caricature. So a lot of people might think that what we're doing is that we have this kind of overarching framework, and then we build a theory within that framework, a spec, an implementation. These are quite often are missed out stages, but still would slot in here. A hypothesis that we test, and then there's the data which gives us like this final answer to our scientific question. So what we think happens is this sort of bidirectional path between every one of these steps that we propose is controlled by basically two very simple rules. So at any point you can move upwards and at any point you can move downwards, provided that you resolve expectation violation. So in the pizza example, the expectation violation was when we assumed that the two pizzas were more food than the one pizza, and we had to resolve that at the specification and implementation stages in the path before we could, for example, move downwards and test any hypotheses and collect any data. Obviously, that's a toy example. We didn't really need to do that, but it is possible to have used the output of the model that said that the one pizza was more food than the two pizzas to then like go off and collect data, for example. And by the same token, we used our spec and implementation to refine our high-level theoretical understanding of the conception of the pizzas or the orders of food. The reason that theory, specification, and implementation are in red is because we believe that these are quite often left out or at least under-discussed, in fact, by both modelers and non-modelers alike. So just to give an example or a couple of examples for each step in the path, at the framework level, we have things like ACTAR and SOAR, which are very formal cognitive architectures that give us very formal building blocks for then moving to build theories. There are also things like connectionism and working memory. So these very almost vague, in some sense, high-level concepts that someone can subscribe to in order to then go off and build a specific theory that relates to that framework. At the theory level, we have ideas about how the world works. So natural language sentences that propose a causal relationship between entities. So things like prospect theory, Ruskola-Wagner, sustain, which is a computational model of categorization. So all these things are coherent wholes that allow us to then move to formally specifying them. So really zooming in on exactly how we want to formalize our theoretical ideas. And this can be done using mathematics, formal specification languages like TLA plus and Z, which are kind of like maths, but look a little bit more like code, but they can't be run. Also natural language, but obviously with natural language, we need to write a lot more down in order to get these details really strongly constrained and specified to remove as much ambiguity as possible. And then from a spec, we can move to implementing things. So transforming these formal ideas, exactly like we did with the pizza example, into code. And let's not forget that these connections are bidirectional. So when you refine something and turn it into code, you can pop back up if you believe that that is important to do so and refine your specification or theory and so on. And then as the output of the implementation, we can get very, very simple things to test. Like, for example, group A will be faster than group B, or the pizza order. So one order of pizza will contain more food than another and so on. And then it's very straightforward to design an experiment and collect data that attempts to answer the simple hypothesis question. And then in terms of the data, we can have a data model using frequentist or Bayesian statistics. So I think this serves to explain or answer the question that I originally asked, which was about where modeling fits in. So in my opinion, in my perspective, we're not separate. We're in fact highly interrelated and interdependent with the rest of psychological science. And the onus is on us or the field in general to have more of these discussions involving the role of computational modeling. Right. So I also think that our PATH model allows us to situate or explain computational modelers' understanding or mathematical psychology's understanding of science. So Rich Schifrin said that science is post hoc with results, especially unexpected results, driving theory and new applications. This idea is completely consistent with our PATH model as well as our general understanding of science. So you have results that you then use to refine your theoretical understanding. That is the kind of core output of the scientific process, an improved theory based on empirical work. On Twitter, what happened is that people confused this or misunderstood this to be referring to hypothesizing after results known. However, in our PATH model, it should be very clear that a hypothesis and a theory are very conceptually different and that there are infinitely many hypotheses that can be derived from a single theory. And the method of testing a theory involves testing many hypotheses. So changing your hypothesis after you know the results is essentially close to, if not exactly, scientific misconduct, while changing your theory after receiving feedback from the universe, essentially after your data doesn't match what you expected, is exactly the normal part of the scientific process. If you don't do that, you obviously are not interested in improving your theory. And that can also be scientific misconduct if you ignore data that otherwise would improve or even obviously reject your theoretical account. Right. So we're obviously not saying that people should do some kind of homework-like exercise where they fill in this PATH model with every detail that they've encountered along the way to developing a new theory or a new computational model or, you know, whatever specific scientific output they're interested in pursuing. However, there might be some value in referring to these steps when we communicate as modelers with the rest of the field. So when we want to explain or situate our work within the wider framework or within the wider field even that we're working in, it might improve our understanding of other people's more empirical work and their understanding of our work if we refer to these stages and if we collaborate with non-modelers to explain to them how their theoretical ideas might be formalizable and might be improved even using computational modeling. This is an especially important thing before as well as after people run experiments. So we can improve both the design of their experiments if we collaborate and communicate with them effectively, as well as improve the interpretation of their experiments after the fact. Nobody believes the result of a simulation except the person who performed the simulation. And everybody believes the result of an experiment except the person who ran the experiment. It might not be the case that we all believe the result of our computational models. However, this quote underlines how we are treated and perceived by the wider field. So, for example, there are cases in which nobody really is interested in the outputs or the repercussions of our computational modeling, which is perhaps especially timely given the state of the world. But what this really underlines isn't so much if we believe the result of our own simulations, but how we're perceived. And I think it's important to remember, even though computational modeling has so much to offer, we shouldn't fall into the trap of being overly arrogant and assuming that the onus is on other people to understand our models. The onus is as much on us as it is on them. And being really clear and explicit and open to discussion and open to really nailing down our spec, especially when we communicate with non-modelers. And we think that our path model can serve as a tool for doing that. Right. So, yeah, thank you very much.